using subtype polymorphism to make the code worse. Let me explain. The only time when you should use subtype polymorphism is when you have variations in behavior in the subtypes. Not when you have variations in data, but when you have variations in behavior. Why? Because then you have a problem that otherwise requires conditionals. And by using subtype polymorphism, subtyping, you avoid these conditionals. This is the principle known as replace conditional with polymorphism. And by replacing these conditionals with polymorphism, you make the code simpler and more flexible. Simpler and more flexible. But if you instead use subtype polymorphism when you have variations in data, not in behavior, then you make the code more complicated and less flexible. So what should you do when you have variations in data? Variations in data and not variations in behavior. Well, you don't need subtype polymorphism. You just need a regular old class. A class can solve your problem if all you have is variations in data. But if you have variations in behavior, then you need subtype polymorphism. Have a look at this first UML diagram. On the top, we have an interface called iAttack. And in the bottom, we then have two subtypes. One is called Thunderbolt and one is called Scratch. So these are two attacks, right? You can imagine like a battle system. Maybe you can think of the game Pokemon, for example. You have these different attacks that have different names and does different amounts of damage. So you can see here in the top, in the supertype, we have one getter, a property, that's called name and is of type string. And we have one getter, which is called damage and is of type integer. So name is the name of the attack and damage is the damage output of that attack. And then for these concrete attacks, for these subtypes, right, Thunderbolt and Scratch, you would have values. So name in Thunderbolt would be probably Thunderbolt, and damage in Thunderbolt might be like 100, and damage in Scratch might be maybe say 50, something like this. Can we, from this diagram, determine whether this is a good use of polymorphism or a bad use of polymorphism? I mean, we'd have to look at the code, but in all likelihood, this is very problematic. Because this, to me, looks like we're talking about variations in data. Why? Because you have properties here. Properties are data. Sure, you can have computed properties that perform some additional calculations, but essentially, the idea of a property is that it encapsulates data. Name is data, and damage output is data. So we wouldn't expect anything else than Thunderbolt to deal some amount of damage, and Scratch to deal some potentially other amount of damage. And that's data. Why don't we need subtype polymorphism for this problem? Because it's just data, then classes can solve this problem perfectly fine. We don't need subtypes. We need a single class called attack. And as you construct it, as you make instances of that class, as you say new attack, you would pass in the name of that attack and you would pass in the damage output of that attack. Here, we're modeling different attacks as classes when in fact the different attacks should be objects. The different attacks, Thunderbolt and Scratch, should not be classes, but should be objects. Because all we've seen so far is variations in data. Next diagram. Here, we're going a step further. Here we are saying that there's still an interface called iAttack, but now the supertype iAttack says that in order to be an iAttack, you must implement the method called use. It's called use and it takes something of type iPlayer. And we call that player the target. And then the method returns void, so it returns nothing. So you can imagine that the idea of this use method is that you would say, I have an attack object and I use that attack upon a particular target, upon a particular player. You have an object you call use and you pass the player that you want to use the attack upon. So we then still have two subtypes, Thunderbolt and Scratch. And both of these, of course, implement the method use in different ways. Can we, if we ignore this part on the bottom, can we from this diagram determine, again, the same question, whether this is good use of subtype polymorphism or bad use of subtype polymorphism? Not really. I mean, now that we have a method, it's not obvious whether we are just encapsulating variations in data or whether we are encapsulating variations in behavior. We have to look at the code. You might have your suspicions, but we have to look at the code. So let's say that in this implementation of use in Thunderbolt, we have something like target.health minus equals 50. We're subtracting 50 from the health of the target. Then let's say that in the other subtype, in Scratch, we have the following code. target.health minus equals 25. We're subtracting 25 from the health of the target. Is this variation in terms of data or variations in terms of behavior? It's variation in terms of data, because the only thing that varies between these two subtypes is whether we are subtracting 50 or whether we are subtracting 25. That's not a behavioral variation, that's data variation. Okay, what did we say? We said, if you only have variations in data, you don't need subtype polymorphism. You can get by with a good old class, a regular class. That would be the simpler solution and the more flexible solution, the more maintainable solution. Why? Because here you could remove these subtypes, only keep the attack class, and in the attack class, you would still take an argument that would correspond to the damage. As you're constructing an instance, as you're instantiating the attack, you would pass whatever damage you want that particular attack object to do. And then that damage data would be used in place of this 50 here or this 25 here. So let's remove these and say, okay, well, it would be X. It's not X, of course, you would call it maybe damage. Let me delete these and go back to what we had before. So by just looking at this diagram, we might say that, yeah, it's possible that this is a sensible use of polymorphism. But as we're digging down into the code, we can see actually this is still not sensible use of polymorphism because we're only encapsulating variations in data. Let's move to the third example. So in this third diagram, we have changed the name of the supertype. We now have a supertype called IMove. And what does it specify that you need to be an IMove? It says that to be an IMove, you must have a method that's called use, and that use method should be applied to a particular target, or an argument that we call target of type IPlayer. And the method still returns void. So it has the same signature that we had in the previous example, in the second example, but now we've changed the name of the supertype to IMove. Why would we do that? Because now, if we're just looking at this progression, it looks like we're trying to increase abstraction further. We're trying to be able to capture more things. We're trying to be able to say that there are multiple different types of things that could be moves that could be used upon a particular target, a target of type IPlayer. One of these things, one such thing, is an attack, but it's not the only thing. And we're now not saying that subtypes are different kinds of attacks. They could be, but we're not saying that that's the only variation. We're now saying that attack is a subtype of IMove. What's a different subtype? Something like, oh my, I changed this example and then I forgot to rewrite it. So this shouldn't say stun, it should say heal. So in this third example, we have two subtypes. One subtype is called attack, and the other subtype is called heal. Both of these would, of course, then implement the method use as specified by their supertype, IMove, and they would do so in different ways. Let's again ignore the red part on the bottom first. Can we, from this diagram, determine whether this is sensible use of polymorphism or problematic use of polymorphism? Not really, but we can certainly have our suspicions. If you just look at the words, if a student would hand this in and I would look at the words, I would say this is, in all likelihood, sensible use of polymorphism. And even if, as we look at the actual code, even if it turns out we're still only looking at variations in terms of data, this would probably be a good starting point for moving into something which does show variations in terms of behavior. But let's look at the code in this particular example. So let's say that what happens in the use method of one of the subtypes, the subtype called attack. What happens in that use method is that the target's health is deducted by X, by some amount. How much? Depends. Now, we can't see that from this diagram, but as you construct an attack, as you instantiate an attack, you could imagine that you would give this attack a name, a string, and some damage output, which would be this X. So this attack captures this idea that we were talking about before. Because in example one, in example two, we were saying, actually, attack, if you just define it like this, attack is a class. It's not a hierarchy, it's a class. We haven't seen any evidence of the fact that we would need a hierarchy. Now, in the future, we might see some evidence, but let's not go there now, because now the simplest solution is just to use a class. Okay, so let's stay with the class. Now that's this class. As you use the attack, you would reduce the health of whoever you're attacking by some amount, and that is determined by the object. Different attacks are different objects. Thunderbolt is one object, Scratch is another object, and so forth. What about the second subtype? The second subtype is called heal. What is inside of its implementation of use? Well, let's imagine that it's something like this. You would take the target, target, you would reset the health to 100, and then you would take the target and you would reset the armor to 100. Now it's a bit silly, I understand, right? Because suddenly I'm introducing this concept of armor that we didn't have before, and like the implementation of attack can't be this simple if we also have armor, because then if you attack someone, you need to first reduce their armor and then reduce their health. Sorry, details, right? But I think you get the general picture. In this subtype called heal, we reset the health of the target and we reset the armor of the target. So if there's a battle between two characters, of course, you would imagine that if this player is using an attack, then it would use the attack on this other player. But if this same player is using a heal move, then it would use it upon itself, of course, right? You would not want to heal your enemy. Unless we are, of course, all very, very kind, which we should be. But that's besides the point. Okay, so heal now has fundamentally different behavior when compared to attack. Why? Why do we say that it has different behavior? Because, look at this. Here we are talking about health. In attack, we are talking about health. Okay, but actually, in heal, we are also talking about health. All right. But in attack, we are using minus equals. We are subtracting from. We are subtracting x from health. Okay. And in heal, what do? We are resetting. We are not using minus equals. We are using equals. This is algorithmically different. This is a different operation. Not the fact that we are accessing health, but the fact that the operation that we are performing upon health is different between the two different subtypes. In one case, we are subtracting from, and in the other case, we are setting to. Two different operators, two different algorithms, algorithmic variation, variations in terms of behavior, not variations in terms of data. It's not just that the amount is varying, it's that the thing we are doing to the thing varies. The thing we are doing varies. Variations in behavior. Okay, we even, just to sort of hammer in this point extra much, we are also accessing an additional property, which is armor, which isn't even accessed in this first subtype. So we're accessing the armor and we're also setting that to some particular value. So clearly the behavior in this right subtype in heal is different from the behavior in the attack. And now, that is the proof that we have usefully, meaningfully used subtype polymorphism to solve a problem where if we didn't use subtype polymorphism, the solution would be worse. Now that we are using subtype polymorphism, the solution is more flexible and simpler. But in these previous cases, we used subtype polymorphism to create a solution which was more complicated and less flexible than the alternative solution, the alternative simpler solution, which was just to use a regular class. Now, let's ask the same question. Can we use a class without subtype polymorphism to solve the problem in this third example? No, not trivially. And if we do that, we have to use conditionals. So if we try to solve this with a class, we end up using conditionals, which makes the code more complicated and less flexible. So here we have a case that requires some switching, some conditionals. And then we can apply the idea of replace conditionals with polymorphism. And by using polymorphism, we end up with a simpler solution that is more flexible. Of course, there are other ways to approach this particular problem that wouldn't necessarily require you to use conditionals. But in all likelihood, they would involve subtype polymorphism. So in summary, the only time when subtype polymorphism is a sensible solution is when you have behavioral variation in your subtypes. And of course, you would at some point in your code have to actually use these objects of the subtype as if they were objects of the supertype. In other words, you would have to upcast them and then dynamically dispatch to this method that exhibits variations in behavior. But more about that another time. Subscribe.